The Federal Trade Commission of the Department of Justice's antitrust division releasing long-awaited drafts now on guidelines to how they plan to enforce merger law. The guidelines outline 13 principles like mergers should not significantly increase concentration in highly concentrated markets, and mergers should not eliminate substantial competition between firms.
In a move that will definitely spark a long battle between big business and the White House, the Biden administration has rolled out new guidelines declaring when the federal government will step in to challenge corporate mergers. The new guidelines, spearheaded by FTC Chair Lina Khan and Assistant Attorney General Jonathan Cantor, aim to modernize how federal agencies review acquisitions with the aim of reducing anti-competitive behavior in the corporate sector. The new guidelines could help prevent corporate consolidation, which of course puts the economy and American workers at a significant disadvantage. More on that later. But first, the details, including how this all began in the first place. Now, within months of his inauguration, Biden issued an executive order on competition policy that called for the rewrite of the merger guidelines that has since informed policy changes at nearly every federal agency. Around the same time, Biden's FTC voted to throw out Trump-era antitrust guidelines, citing how flawed it was. Today, we got a sense of what those guidelines will be replaced with. The rules will impact both vertical mergers, which involve transactions between two businesses that are in different parts of the supply chain in an industry, and horizontal mergers, which involve similar companies that are competing in a similar part of the market. The new guidelines are outlined in a 13-point list that will be used to evaluate whether a merger should be blocked. And honestly, if you ask me, they make a lot of sense. For example, mergers should not significantly increase concentration in highly concentrated markets. Mergers should not eliminate substantial competition between firms. Mergers should not eliminate a potential entrant in a concentrated market. Mergers should not substantially lessen competition by creating a firm that controls products or services that its rivals may use to compete. Notice the main point here: to increase competition. That is a good thing, right? They also note that mergers should, you know, essentially ensure that there is enough competition. Mergers should not entrench or extend a dominant position. Mergers should not further a trend toward concentration. When a merger is part of a series of multiple acquisitions, the agencies may examine the whole series. So based on what I'm seeing here, makes a lot of sense, sounds like good news. You want competition in our economy. And here's more on the guidelines from Assistant Attorney General Jonathan Cantor.
We're trying to understand the extent to which the merger will risk threatening competition. And so what courts have said over a century is that if it reduces substantial competition between competitors, or if it tends to create a monopoly by entrenching monopoly power, or building a moat around a firm that already has monopoly power, or increases a trend toward concentration so that the only way to compete is to be massive, then those are exactly the kinds of mergers that can violate the Clayton Act and be subject to legal scrutiny.
So look, we're getting a little clarity here. That's a good thing, a little transparency in regard to what the DOJ and the Federal Trade Commission plan to focus on when it comes to potentially blocking certain mergers and acquisitions. And again, if the point is to compete competition, these guidelines as they stand today make a lot of sense. And according to FTC Chair Lina Khan, they're also rooted in precedent.
So these guidelines reflect the law. If you look through the document, you'll see a lot of footnotes to appellate court decisions, to Supreme Court decisions. We read through every litigated merger decision that resulted in a decision from the Federal Court of Appeals or the Supreme Court. And so this document is designed to make sure that everybody is on notice about what the state of the law is. And we'll be relying, right now we put out this draft guidelines. We'll be collecting public comment for 60 days. We're very eager for public input.
And look, in reading the details about these new guidelines, what really stands out is how the Biden administration wants to reverse Reagan-era policies that really paved the way for corporate consolidation. Antitrust enforcement agencies in the Reagan administration adopted a lax review standard that encouraged mergers and acquisitions and looked favorably on monopolies for promoting market efficiency. This standard gained bipartisan acceptance and has dominated antitrust enforcement ever since, much to our detriment. Now, here's more on what that meant for ordinary people over the last 40 years.
In the 1980s, it became easier to make money buying and merging companies than actually like running them profitably. The merger of RJ Reynolds Tobacco, maker of Winston cigarettes, and Nabisco, which gave us Oreos, not only created a cancer and heart disease dream team, it also generated nearly $1 billion for the lawyers and bankers who put the deal together. But if you were like most of us in the 80s, watching Dallas and Dynasty, working at your regular job, inexplicably having a carpeted bathroom, then you probably didn't share in that abundance. The 80s saw rising economic inequality, although not nearly as dramatic as we see today. By the mid-1990s, the richest 1% controlled 40% of the nation's wealth, double the share from 20 years before.
People really did have rugs and not rugs, but like carpet in the bathroom. Just the 80s were wild, man. Anyway, reversing some of those failed anti-competitive rules in favor of corporations would be great, to say the least. Competition obviously gives both consumers and workers more options. If the market is dominated by one or a handful of companies, there's less pressure for big business to innovate, to provide a better product, better customer service, or compete for workers with better pay and benefits packages. Look, just look at the recent actions the federal government took in regard to consolidation in the food industry. So the US Department of Agriculture announced Wednesday that it has entered into a partnership with the attorneys general of 32 states and the District of Columbia to target anti-competitive behavior in food markets. The partnership would allow cooperation in competition lawsuits that seek to reduce food prices, combat price gouging, increase food access, and thwart anti-competitive behavior that threatens food supply chains. Finally, I want to focus on the very sixth point on the list of antitrust guidelines, because it has to do with the story we've been covering here at TYT. So it notes that vertical mergers should not create market structures that foreclose competition. One of the contested vertical mergers that has earned FTC Chair Lina Khan the ire of corporate America is Microsoft's attempt to buy Activision Blizzard. Now, Microsoft, which makes Xbox consoles, has proposed to spend a whopping $68.7 billion to buy Activision Blizzard, which creates the games. That would mean more consolidation under Microsoft in the gaming industry, and the FTC decided to challenge the deal. But just last week, a federal court declined to grant the agency's request to stop the merger, and the FTC is now appealing the court's decision. We'll fill you all in as that story develops. Anyway, the corporate press is handling this news, well, poorly. Perhaps they should have given themselves just a tiny bit of time to balance their sodium levels before spouting off on air. But they didn't, and Lina Khan agreed to appear on CNBC's Squawk Box to answer questions about the new antitrust guidelines. I just want to focus on the questions being asked during this interview.
You know, I want to reference a letter from what was then the outgoing commissioner, Christine Wilson. She was very critical of you. And of the what she said was the dissatisfaction amongst the staff. You lost in the US court. Why not drop the action from there? Why seeking appeal? Why are you continuing to follow, for example, along with the ALJ proceeding? She says, your leadership has led to the departures of many experienced personnel, causing a notable brain drain. There was a lot of back and forth that would appear based on a Freedom of Information request between the FTC and the CMA involving Microsoft and Activision. Seems somewhat unusual. How much does what they do figure into what how you think about what you do? Why was there a need at all to talk to the CMA about Activision and Microsoft? And goes on to say, pains are to observe the tarnishing of the FTC's reputation and the diminution of its efficacy.
Hey, here's a letter from former members of your staff who think you're a piece of garbage. How do you respond? Look, in all seriousness, I actually don't mind the tough questions. However, it would be nice to watch hedge fund managers and corporate executives get grilled the same way federal regulators do when they appear on CNBC. Now, the guidelines will enter a 60-day public comment phase, and they are, very much likely to go through some changes as a result of that process. There's more, though, that the Biden administration should get a little bit of credit for. Believe it or not, I'm being positive toward the Biden administration, but credit where credit is due. For instance, back in March, Housing and Urban Development Secretary Marcia Fudge began cracking down on hidden and excessive fees, including rental application fees and hidden charges for things like trash collection and other services that renters usually presume is already baked into their rent. As a result, digital real estate platforms like Zillow, Apartments.com, and AffordableHousing.com will now include these often hidden fees when they list prices on rental properties. So again, credit where credit is due. When the Biden administration makes good decisions or appoints really strong individuals like Lina Khan to do the job that previous administrations were unwilling to do, I'm gonna give them credit. And there's nothing more important at the moment than ensuring that there is competition in our economy, that there's less consolidation. And what I would like to see is in the future, maybe, breaking up some of these major corporations that were able to do some of the consolidation that has led to a lack of options, a lack of, various places for workers to work in as a result of Reagan's policies that have been implemented over the last, four decades. So we'll see how this all develops. We'll see what happens after the, 60-day comment period. But I do love that despite all this pressure from corporate-backed politicians, Lina Khan refuses to concede to them. She keeps fighting. And I'm glad that she's appealing that federal court's ruling on the Microsoft Activision Blizzard merger. We'll see how that plays out as well.
Thanks for watching The Young Turks. Really appreciate it. Another way to show support is through YouTube memberships. You'll get to interact with us more. There's live chat, emojis, badges. You've got emojis of me, Anna, John, JR. So those are super fun. But you also get playback of our exclusive member only shows and specials right after they air. So all of that, all you gotta do is click that join button right underneath the video. Thank you.